Can't start without these. Bless the Lord, heals my eyes. Praise the Lord. It's welcome to the house of the Lord. It's great to be back here after a time away, and it's great to be back in the house of the Lord here. I did go on vacation and enjoyed the service there, but it's great to be back here home. Hope you came expecting. God is really speaking powerfully, and I hope you're getting it. I'm like excited about this series as to how much truth we can glean from what is actually happening in the world today. And if you take the, I don't want to get into my sermon now, but if you take the letters to the seven churches and you look at the world today, it's unfolding. It's the same, and history is repeating itself because we forget about things, and we time dulls our senses and our memory. So that's all I'll say about that, except that I'm really excited about what God's doing. So I pray today that you will open your hearts and your mind and let the Holy Spirit minister to you in worship. Worship with all you got. I know you do, but you know, the old chorus says, forget about yourself and concentrate on Him. If we can do that today, and just let the Lord minister to you and touch you in ways that we don't even know how He can do, because He's so amazing. The 15th, the ladies and the men will be starting up again. There's a sign up back there in the foyer. And October 8th will be Pastor Appreciation. We'll have a dinner. It'll be nice to have another dinner. the ladies will be here September 15th, and the guys will get you I'll have Paul or one of us will text where it's going to be. And we got one more week. I can announce it next week at another restaurant opened. So, but it's the 15th at 6 o'clock, and then October 8th will be Pastor Appreciation Day, and we'll be having a dinner. So praise the Lord. Let's get ready to rock today and let the Holy Spirit minister. You know, when you're all refreshed and you're ready to, I told them we were gonna have a song for the offering, but I share this because you know I share my heart. You know I don't hold back much. I was weed eating the ditch yesterday, and I had my earbuds in and I heard a song that I hadn't heard before, and you're gonna hear the video today. And Marty goes, "Oh yeah, we do that in worship on Saturday night," and so we'll be singing this song probably next week, but. I just got so charged for the hour it took me to do the whole ditch. I kept pulling my phone out and hitting repeat for the whole time. And then I watched the video last night and I saw that. And I couldn't leave it to go to bed. It ministered to me so powerfully. So I think it'll minister to you too. I'll say it again, but let's just get ready to hear what the Lord has to say, and let's worship Him today, and let's let Him make changes in our life. Let Him encourage us. Let Him strengthen us. Lord, we just thank You today for the privilege and the opportunity to come into Your house. Lord, I pray as we lift up our voices, as we worship You, as we sing praises, Lord, that You would just come and move in Your mighty and precious way. Lord, that You would touch lives today. Lord, change lives, heal, Lord, strengthen, encourage, Lord. Let us not leave this place the same that we came, Lord. Lord, let us leave here renewed and strengthened and revived in the power of Your Holy Spirit. Move by Your Spirit today, Lord, I pray. In Jesus' name, and everybody said,
amen.
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 Hallelujah, glory to Your name.
Yeah.
that today, that the Lord is with you?
I walk with you, my Lord.
we praise you, Lord. You I live for every day. Hallelujah, we worship your name, Lord Jesus. We worship your name, Lord.
Water. Hallelujah, we worship you, Lord. You reign, Lord. You reign, Lord, in glory. You reign in glory, Lord. We worship your name. There is a fountain. Who is the king? Victorious warrior. Lord, you're the Lord of everything. You're my rock, my shelter. You're my very own. My blessed redeemer. You reign upon the throne. There is a fountain. Who's the king? Victorious warrior. The Lord of everything. My rock, my shelter.
Your name, we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, we worship your name, Lord. praise your holy name, Lord. Christ alone, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship your name, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Christ alone. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord, we worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord, we worship your name. Hallelujah, Lord, we worship you, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. We worship your name. Christ alone, we worship you, Lord. We worship your name, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship your name. For you are worthy, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oran dirarara mashite ira korarara masite le ondande andarara mashite ungaita mashite sitando mashite. Hallelujah.
You are my reflections down here, my people. You are my reflections down here, my people. When other people see you, they not only see you, but they see my glory through you, my people. You are my representatives down here.
We
are
going.
Presence of your Holy Spirit, for your faithfulness, Lord, in every situation, in every circumstance. Lord, I thank you today that we have you to lean upon. We have you to trust in. We have you, Lord, to strengthen and encourage us. Lord, you are our all in all. Lord, I pray today as we have worshiped you, as your Holy Spirit is here, as you have spoken your message here in this place today. Lord, I pray today as we come before your throne of grace for every need that is presented in this body, Lord. For in our humanity, Lord, there are many needs. Lord, but you are our strength. You are our strong tower. You are that which we must lean upon and can lean upon. You're always there, Lord. You never leave us or forsake us. Standing somewhere in the shadows, we'll find Jesus, the friend who cares and always understands. Who knows us better than we know ourselves? Lord, today, I pray, Lord, for every sickness, every infirmity, every pain, Lord. Today, Lord, in Jesus' name, for those in this place, for those unable to be here, for those, Lord, that you would just touch them. Bring healing, Lord, that only you can do. You are the God that healeth. You are he, Lord, that can restore, renew, and strengthen, Lord. Today, in Jesus' name, in this house, Lord, right now, for those here and those unable to be here, Lord, I pray the power of your Holy Spirit, I pray your healing, Lord, would flow from the top of their head to the soles of their feet, Lord, right now, in Jesus' name. Lord, miracles would take place. Lord, miracles would happen, Lord. Lord, you're a miracle-working God. You didn't stop it, Lord. You didn't stop it in the Bible times. You're still doing it today. You're still working miracles, Lord. And I pray today, Lord, would be a miracle day in this house, Lord. All over this congregation, all over this body, Lord. Lord, those that are attached to this body, Lord, that we lift up to you today, that we come, Lord, with expectation and humbleness before your throne of grace, and we lay them before your altar, Lord, before the feet of the cross, Lord, but by your stripes that we were healed. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, the name that breaks every stronghold, I speak Jesus in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah today. Oh, Ramasito Rabobakito Raramakito Rabababakita Ramahai. Glory to your name, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray for every need that is presented here today. Lord, I pray for those that are down. I pray for those that are anxious. I pray for those that are depressed. I pray, Lord, for those with uncertainty in their hearts and their minds. Lord, you're our peace that passes all understanding. You're the glory and the lifter of our head. Lord, you are the joy that gives us our strength. So today, Lord, as I prayed in the beginning, I pray, Lord, that not a single person that is here today in this place, not a single person that hears or watches this, Lord, would not be changed, would not receive encouragement, would not receive your strength, would not receive life-changing, supporting nutrition from the Holy Spirit today. In this place, and Lord, for those that watch or listen to this, you are not bound by the walls of this church. Lord, your Holy Spirit is about this whole world for those that will receive him and those that will allow him to manage construct and reconstruct and move in their lives. Lord, I pray today is a day for a miracle. I pray today is a new day, Lord, for someone to change and turn their life around. Today is the day, Lord. There's no day like today. Lord, I pray today you make that difference, because you are all the difference in the world. By your Spirit, Lord, it's not by any person's might, but by your Spirit, saith the Lord. Lord, we're so glad that we have you to trust in. We're so glad that we have this privilege and opportunity to come together, brothers and sisters in the Lord, to worship you and to praise you. And we just thank you for it in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. As we prepare our hearts to continue to worship the Lord in the communion, hallelujah, prepare your heart that you might be right before the Lord today. As we prepare for communion, hallelujah, glory to God. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As they pass that out, we'll sing the song they all have. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And prepare your hearts before Him today. Above all power, above all king, above all creature and all created things. What a powerful song. Above all wisdom in all the ways of man. You were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms. Partake of communion, Lord. Lord, that we present ourselves before you spotless, only by your blood, Lord. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would forgive us of any sin or any wrong that we may have in our heart today, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we might come to you in a worthy fashion as we present to you, Lord, as we partake of this communion in remembrance of the price you paid. In remembrance of what you did for us, Lord. And Lord, I pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Lord, I thank you today for the stripes that you received. You bore all the sins of the world. You bore each of our sins. And for those to even come in the days ahead, And Lord, today, in remembrance of that, we offer this symbol of your body that was broken for us. And Lord, we thank you for it, and we ask you to bless it as we do this in remembrance of you. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said, amen. You can partake. Hallelujah. Lord, we know that there is no remission of sins without the shedding of blood. The blood of goats and bulls and animals couldn't cut it. There was needed to be the perfect, unblemished sacrifice. And you sent your son Jesus, and he came knowing his purpose and knowing that he would suffer inhumanely. Yet he came, and yet he shed his blood that we might be cleansed from all unrighteousness, that we would no longer need to do the sacrifices, because he would be the sacrifice that ended all sacrifices. So Lord, today as we present this symbol of your blood that was shed on Calvary, Lord, I pray that you would bless it. I pray, Lord Jesus, as we do it in remembrance of you, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You may drink. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Crucified, lay behind the stone. He lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. He took the fall and thought of me, of all. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. As we continue to worship the Lord in our with our giving today, if the come forward to take our tithes and offerings, hallelujah, glory to God. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're good. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you today for your goodness, your faithfulness to us. You're Jehovah Jireh, our provider. And Lord, I pray today, Lord, that you would bless as your people give. Bless them. Bless them pressed down, shaken together, and running over, Lord. Bless them as they return to you a portion of what you've given them. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. We got a video for you today. And as I told in the beginning of the service, it's a new song to me, and we'll sing it in the coming weeks. But as I was weed eating my ditch yesterday, I was listening to worship music, and I hit the repeat button through the whole course of the time that I did the worship and listen to this, but you'll see why. It's powerful. I just want you to sit back and sing it. If you know the song, sing it with them. It's in a pretty high key, but you might be able to do the lower octave. But be blessed and be ministered to in the power, and let the Lord just minister to you in this song. Hallelujah. Been playing it over and over again. Hallelujah. You never know what you'll hear when you're weed eating your ditch. And I'm just glad I didn't drop my phone in the water when I kept taking it out to hit the repeat for an hour straight. 7 minutes, so I should know the song pretty good. Praise the Lord. Speak Jesus. I speak Jesus. I want to continue the series where we left off 2 weeks ago. I know it probably wasn't a good thing to take 2 weeks in the middle of a series and be away, but nonetheless, I'll do a quick overview just in a minute. But I want to continue with Sardis, and I am really excited about how much these letters to the churches really are what is it happening in the world. There's many different facets in this letter where Christ is making it aware to them and to us today. And we need to look at ourselves, and we need to take a look at these letters and ask ourselves, do we fit into categories here that need correction or that need some amendments or changes? So we're walking according to God's word, and how do we do that? If we have ears to hear, we listen to what the Spirit has to say. And this is the second part of Sardis, and there will be a third part next week. I never know till I get into it how long and what the Lord, he shows me. But next week we'll finish up with Sardis, and I already started reading Philadelphia, and that might be a few weeks also. So praise the Lord. Let's read the scripture of Revelation chapter 3, verse 1. Write this letter to the angel of the church of Sardis. This is the message from the one who has sevenfold spirit of God and the seven stars. I know all the things you do, and that you have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. Wake up! Strengthen what little remains, for even what is left is almost dead. I find that your actions do not meet the requirements of my God. Go back to what you heard and believed at first. Hold it firmly. Repent and turn to me. Lord, I thank you today that we have the name of Jesus to speak, that we have Christ alone to be our cornerstone, to be our foundation on which we stand. And Lord, today I pray, as you are ministering in this place, as your Holy Spirit is here touching and changing lives, I pray, Lord, as I bring forth your word, that you would anoint me and it would be your words and not mine, that you would hide me behind the cross, that we might glean truth from your word and rightly divide it. Lord, today, speak through your vessel, I pray, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. In the second part of the letter of the church to Sardis, let's remember, going back to John chapter 16 and Galatians 5, that the Holy Spirit guides us into all truth. And by his guidance, if we will listen to him and we will follow his instructions into what he says, we will avoid the pitfalls of the sinful desires of our flesh in our lives in these difficult last days. And that's what the Holy Spirit was sent for. Those are his roles, to avoid the pitfalls, to help us to be strong. And I told you that I listened to a minister, and he did a series on this, and he called it, "What kind of church are you? What kind of church are you?" If you were to look at the letters and you were to look at the seven churches, what category would you fit into? What church would you be? And we ask ourselves that, and we look at this today and as we go through this series. Sardis was a city about 50 miles east of Smyrna. I told you this a couple weeks ago, but let's review it because it's important. The information is important. And it's about 30 miles southwest of Thyatira. It was the capital city of Lydia, and it was located on the commercial trade route. It was a strong fortress because of its location. It was 1,500 feet on a plateau of a mountain. And that's important to understand because They thought they were impenetrable. They thought they were unbeatable. They could have been because of their placement. Croesus was their king, and he led from Lydia, or he ruled from Sardis, and he was said to be one of the greatest of their kings. He was a very wealthy king, and Sardis rose to its greatest splendor under Croesus and his kingship, but it also found its destruction during his reign. He was so wealthy that there was an expression, as rich as Croesus, originated from him. And he gained his wealth from gold and silver. But he had such an imperialistic arrogance. You know, he wasn't happy with what he had. He wanted more ground. He wanted more area. So he sought to take on the great Persian Empire under King Cyrus. He consulted with false priestess, the Oracle of Delphi, and he was told that if he crossed the river Halys, that he will destroy a great empire. Well, he thought it meant that he would destroy the Persian Empire, when in actuality what he was being told was his empire will be destroyed if he crosses the Halys River. So he did cross the river, and he engaged in battle with the Persians, and he lost. And they retreated, and they didn't think anything of it. That didn't bother them, because they thought, because of their location, they thought that they were impenetrable. They thought that they couldn't be defeated, that nobody could get to them. So they didn't think, oh, well, we lost that battle. We retreated, and we're back up on our mountain. So one day, it's the oddest thing, isn't it? One day, there's a soldier, and his helmet rolls down the hill. And it comes out, and he said, well, I got to go get the helmet. But what had happened was Cyrus offered a reward for the person that would find a way to get to the Sardinians. Not the Sardines, but the Sardinians. He offered a reward. So they besieged the city for 14 days, and they watched them. And when the soldier dropped his helmet, he went down the hill through this little fault or crack, and he was able to go out and get his helmet. And the Persian soldiers were watching this, and they said, ha ha, there's a hole in their armor. And so that night, they gathered a group of soldiers, the Persian soldiers, and they went into that area, that passageway. And they climbed the mountain, and what did they find? But all the armaments of the Sardinians, all their armaments were left unguarded, and they were all asleep because they were complacent and they left everything unguarded, and they were sleeping because they were complacent in their own self-control, their own self-strength. Hey, we're up here. Nobody's going to ever get to us. We're in unstoppable. We're unbeatable. Well, they fell that night. They were destroyed. They were beat by the Persians because of their complacency. And 2 weeks ago, I mentioned to you, Jesus starts. Every letter that starts, Jesus mentions who he is that pertains to the particular situation. Isn't that something? He's our all in all. And in this situation, he says, I am the sevenfold Spirit of God and the seven stars. And we will, just a quick review, the seven spirits represent the perfect completeness of the roles of the Holy Spirit in all he is commissioned to do, and the importance of his role influencing our lives. And you know what? It's more than the goosebumps, and it's more than the flashbangs. You know, it's more than, and I said this 2 weeks ago, and I say it over and over again, because this is really what the Lord is trying to say to his people. And I said this I'm all about getting excited, and you see that, you know that. I'm all about, you know, shouting and jumping. I'm all about the power of God, you know, maybe taking people, knocking them down once in a while, and they're on the floor. I don't mean knocking them down like they're laying slain in the spirit, as he does some work in their lives, as he takes them on a little journey maybe while they're down there. That's all wonderful, and I'm not against it. You know we do that. We have that. But I'm talking about the Holy Spirit that impacts every day of our life. That voice that I tell you that I hear that, and I'm not the only one that should hear him. We all should be hearing him. He should all be speaking into our lives. That's the Holy Spirit I'm talking about. In Revelation, the second part of verse 1, he said, I know all the things you do, that you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. In this case, in other cases, he said, I know the things you do, and that was an encouragement. But here it's not. Here it's a rebuke, because they're not doing. The church was thought to have it all going on. They were the church, remember? A few people were joking with me after service, and the church. They were the church, you know. Everybody knew about the church of Sardis. Everybody knew about them. They were the mega church of the time. They had all the money, the fame, the notoriety, all the program, their works, and their confidence was all in those things, in building a thriving church. Now, there's nothing wrong with building a thriving church, depending on what the focus of your purpose is. Ultimately, the church is being built for the kingdom of God, and not just the church, but they were building the church just to be the church. So we can be the church. So to say, I attended the church today. Christ and his Holy Spirit may be named in voice, but his presence is absent and unwelcome there. He's not allowed to be there. No time, ain't nobody got time for the Lord to minister. So my attendance really doesn't make any difference in my life. But nonetheless, I attend the church. I don't care what church it is. If Jesus and his Spirit are not allowed to be there, aren't given the time to move, there's no reason to even have church. There's no reason. If we aren't here to see him, there's no reason for us to be here. It explained a 2 Timothy when Paul wrote to Timothy 3:5, he and different versions, they will maintain the facade of religion, but their conduct will deny its validity. Some powerful ways this is said. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. And this one was really powerful. Though they keep a form of religion, they will have nothing to do with it as a force. I do it all. I do all these works, but it doesn't affect my life. And this is what the Lord's trying to get across to his people in the Sardis and the people today. He said to them, wake up. Wake up. There's three, I don't usually do this, there's three points to this message. Wake up, remember, and repent. Wake up, remember, and repent. He says to them, wake up in verse 2. Strengthen what little remains, for even what is left is almost dead. I find that your actions do not meet the requirements of God. And you know, if we're listening to the Holy Spirit here at First Assembly, and those that might listen or watch this later, if you will recall a few weeks ago, the Lord delivered this message. Wake up! Wake up! We remember that he identified Sardis as a church that is alive, but is really dead. In a commentary, I want you to really get this. Benson in his commentary said this, therefore awake to the sense of thy danger. Is there danger around us? Spiritually, and stand on thy guard against the enemies, visible and invisible. Here's the key, saints, which threaten thy what? Eternal destruction. Worry not as much about what can kill the body as what can kill the soul and body, is what he's saying there. Amen? Eternity's a long time. We might think 100 years on earth is a long time, and it is to us. But 1,000 years is like a day to the Lord, and eternity is a lot longer. Sardis, wake up. You've fallen asleep in complacency, in your own self-confidence and pride. Everything's going good for you. You got name, you got fame, you got money. You got all things, beautiful things. Everything's wonderful for you. And you believe you're indestructible. Your own powers and abilities and your location and your money. And you left yourself unguarded. You're vulnerable. Complacency makes us vulnerable, saints. When we become complacent, well, everything's going great, so I'll just spin in my own direction. I'll become complacent. Everything's going wonderful. Now, there's nothing wrong with being confident. We need to be confident. But our confidence must be in the power of the Holy Spirit working in our lives and not in our own strength. Confidence in the Creator and not created things or beings. I'm confident because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen? We're confident in the fact that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Barnes, in his notes, refers to the drowsy condition of the church. My father used to say, "Brother Pillow and Sister Blanket." That's the church they attended. Believers are urged throughout the New Testament to be awake and be on watch. In Romans chapter 13, in verse 11 in the New Living Translation, it tells us this is all the more urgent, for you know how late it is. Time is running out. Wake up, for our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. In the King James, it says, "And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than we believed." In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, "Stay alert, watch out." Why? For the great enemy, the devil, he prowls like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. In the King James, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour." If you ever watch the nature on TV and you watch the lions as they walk around and they're looking for a vulnerable animal. They're looking for the one that they could get the easiest prey out of. And that's what our enemy's doing. You know, after 9/11, the Homeland Security, and it still goes on today, had a campaign, "If you see something, say something." If you see something that doesn't look right, if you're in the airport and there's a package that just doesn't look right, maybe there's some wires hanging out of a bag or something, maybe there's a bunch of blocks taped together with wires hanging out of it, tell somebody about it. And you know, as I was preparing this, we as Christians, if we see something, we need to say something. And what do we need to say? We need to say to the devil, what? What do we give him? The word, "Get behind me," the word of God. What did Jesus give the devil? The word of God. We see something, we see the enemy approaching, give him the word of God. Wake up, be on guard, don't let our guard down. Paul, when he was writing, speaking to the Thessalonians in chapter 1 Thessalonians 5, 6, he says to them, "Be on your guard, not asleep like the others. Stay alert and be clear-headed. Night is the time when people sleep and drinkers get drunk. But let who live in the light be clear-headed, protected by the armor of their faith and love." Get this, wearing as our helmet the confidence of our salvation. You know, I read that over and over. And as I read that this morning, the Lord said, ding, 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 ding. The confidence in our salvation. Where's our salvation? It's in the Lord. It's in the blood that he shed for us that we just remembered in having communion. In the book of Acts, chapter 20, verse 29, Paul writing to, said, I know the false teachers like vicious wolves will come in among you after I leave, not sparing the flock. Even some from your own group will rise up and distort the truth in order to draw a following. People in the church trying to draw a following. I'm not saying here, but I'm saying in the church in general. And they will say whatever, churches will say whatever to tickle ears and distort the gospel and just to make it fit into how people want it to fit in their lives. He said in verse 31, watch out! In this version, you see there's a big exclamation point after that, like a shout. Watch out! Remember the 3 years I was with you, my constant watch and care over you, night and day, and my tears for you. Sardis was so confident in themselves that they left themselves unguarded and slept without anyone on watch. You know, in the military, they have people watching. They don't, like, everybody doesn't go to sleep and then they leave, like, all of their stuff unguarded. Somebody has to do watch. Somebody's got to be awake to make sure if the enemy comes in. It doesn't mean we never sleep physically. It doesn't mean that we never relax. But we have to be on guard. We need to watch. We need to be thinking, what's the enemy trying to attack? What's going on? They were attacked and destroyed during their unguarded sleep. And the letter here says, wake up. And we ask ourselves today, if the Holy Spirit has said to us, wake up. We ask ourselves as a church and individually, have we become complacent, self-confident, and have we fallen asleep or left ourselves unguarded while the enemy, both visible and invisible, is sneaking his way in, and he's worming his way in. He doesn't, remember I told you, the enemy doesn't just bounce in and, hey, I'm here to mess your life up. He does little things to sneakily get in there. He does little things to bother you here and to bother you there. And before you know it, you accept it. You think it's okay. And then we get dulled into that complacency. And the next thing you know, he's got your head spinning and he's got you sleeping. And he's just working all overtime on you. In the letter, Jesus goes on to tell them, preserve and strengthen what little bit is alive. That little spark, that ember that's still burning. You know, they had those old fans for the fireplaces. Fan the flame of the Holy Spirit. Stir up the gifts. Fan the flame. He's saying to them, what little is left there, start with that. The old song, it only takes a spark to get the fire going. It's like a wilting plant. Give it some food. Give it some food before it's all dried up. And he said this to them, I found thy works were not perfect. That word perfect in the Greek here means that they weren't complete. They weren't full. And why were they not complete? They fell short of what was required. Why? Because their focus and the purpose of their works was distorted and was not on Christ. Their works and their purpose were not were not to build the kingdom of God, but it was to build the church. Their focus was not in allowing the Holy Spirit and the power of God to minister, to change their lives, to make a difference in their lives that he might make a difference in other people's lives. What did the Lord say today? People will see him in us. That's what it's all about. The Holy Spirit working in us and other people see that. Nobody wants, you know, if we don't have anything different than the world to offer, nobody will need that. I got my own problems. I don't need yours too. We all have problems. If you're awake, you're alive, we all have problems. If you don't think you do, God bless you. They lack the correct focus and purpose. Wake up. Secondly, he says to remember. Revelation 3, verse 3 says, go back to what you heard and believed at first. Hold it firmly. I always bring this up. It's over and over again, but you got to think about it. David always would remember. He expressed himself in song, and he was so much in expressing through the Psalms and Lamentation how much he would go through, and then he would say, but I remembered what the Lord did for me. Paraphrasing many of his situations. I remembered how the Lord did this. I remembered how the Lord did that. Paul, writing to Timothy again in 2 Timothy in the first chapter in verse 13, he says to him, hold on to the pattern of the wholesome teaching you learned from me, a pattern shaped by faith and love that you have in Christ. Go back to that enthusiasm and the truth that you first received when you were converted. Hold on to that. Don't be diverted. Don't go down the this road. Don't go down that road. Don't listen to this over here. Don't listen to that over there. Stay true to the truth. Stay and hold on to that. Go back to when you received the good news from Christ, when it was Christ-centered and not church-centered or whatever else we might have it centered on. In his commentary, Meyer says, once it had received this with holy zeal of heart, but now it was only with the head. Isn't that interesting? At once they received it from their heart, but now it was only in their head. It was just, that's what we do. I go to church because it's Sunday and we go to church. It's good to be in practice to go to church. But it's good to be in practice to go to church to receive and to offer praise and worship to the Lord and to receive from Him and to hear what He has to say to us corporately together. They kept a form of religion, but they had nothing to do with it as a force. Remember, Sardis, go back to when you first heard the truth. In Thessalonians, again, verse 5 of chapter 1, for we brought you the good news. It was not only words, but also with power. That's the key here. And you, for the Holy Spirit gave you full assurance that what we said was true. And you know of our concern for you from the way we lived when we were with you. We spoke of the power and the authority. We spoke with the power and authority of the Holy Spirit. Paul, as he's writing to the Thessalonians, we didn't just come to you with words. I tell you every week, I don't want to just stand up here and read you a sermon or preach you something. Oh, this sounds good today. I think we'll do that. I think I'll just open the Bible or open my and point to something. Oh, we'll do that today. Now, if I'm directed by the Lord, I'll do that, but that's not. I share with you that I started, the Lord said to me, you know, I'm telling you to hear what the Spirit is saying because it's in your best interest to listen. And when He gives them, when there's a message in tongues and there's an interpretation, hear what He's saying because He's given us encouragement. He's given us direction. He's giving us maybe correction too. And there's a purpose for it. And that's the reason, the importance of the Holy Spirit to speak. Go back to that. He doesn't tell them to go back and live in the past or to dwell in the past. He tells them to go back to the truth that you were taught when you were first converted and how it changed your life. How the truth changed your life. You know, sometimes with the passage of time, our memory can grow dull. My memory grows dull all the time. But returning to a place of a great experience or a bad experience can refresh our memory and can rekindle the thrill and the intensity that the passage of time has dulled. Maybe you took, you know, if you think about it, maybe you took a trip one time and it was wonderful. And it was a great trip. Maybe you went to a crusade and it was a great crusade. And you go back to that. Maybe you met somebody at that crusade. Maybe you end up getting married to that person. You go back to that and you say, that was a point in the end. It doesn't mean we live in that time. But we draw from that in our memory and we don't forget about it. I thought of this. Why do employers have to issue reminder memos for rules and procedures? Always. Why do they have to issue memo reminders? I want to remind everyone that. Well, if we study the Old Testament, we see the roller coaster ride of the Israelites and how they would drift away from God, forgetting his instructions to them and all that he's done for them, losing trust in him and forgetting what his expectations were. God had to issue them many memos. And unfortunately, his memos to them were in the form of captivity and destruction sometimes. There's a real danger for us as believers that time dulls our memory and we lose the truth and the purpose of the message of the gospel. And we miss out and we can't lose that message. That time, we have to be careful that time doesn't dull us into complacency or dull us to sleep. If this happens, we have to go back and rekindle the flame of in our memory and regain the truth of the gospel message and hold on to it firmly. Hold fast to what you were taught. And I say this as a question, and you can respond. Who reminds us of the truth that we were taught? Who reminds us? Interactive here. Who reminds us of the truth that we were taught? The Holy Spirit. That's one of his functions. That's one of his roles. The inference in the scripture, too, is to keep remembering and don't forget. Don't forget. I have to put reminders all over on my phone. And like if I could have something give me an electric shock, that would be helpful, too. What's that noise? Oh, it's your phone telling you you need to do this or you were supposed to do that. People say, some people still write in calendars. God bless you. I put it in my phone and it beeps and I could get dulled to the beep. Oh, that's just another beep. It's just another beep. It's just the Holy Spirit telling me again and again. And again, well, I'll let this slide, I'll let that slide, and I dull into complacency till I miss an appointment. Till I miss an appointment with the Holy Spirit. Ooh. Till I miss an appointment with the Lord. Remember what Paul told in Acts. I know of that false teachers like vicious wolves will come in among you after I leave. Are there false teachers in the world today? You know, some people, I hear so much. And again, don't. I'm not knocking prophetic because I believe in it. But there are so many people prophesying about this, that, and the other thing. We have to really make sure that, first of all, what are they prophesying and what does it really mean for the kingdom of God, number one? And number two, how does it affect my life and eternity? How does it affect my eternal destruction or not? It doesn't mean that we don't listen to everything. But, hey, no different than what I've preached over the years. Don't sell your house and all your belongings because somebody said to you, go be a missionary in Africa. If God didn't speak to you and you go do that, it's not going to be so good. When I can't remember her married name now, Deanna Richardson, was here from, she's a missionary to Tibet. She talked about eating some eggs that ants would come out of while you're still eating them. And that was her hardest thing to eat, she said, in being in Tibet. See, that's a memory that will jog. That's an event that will jog your memory. I'm sure if she saw this and saw the ants on like a plate, it would jog her memory about that. Paul said to was saying to them, even some men from your own group will rise up and distort the truth in order to draw a following. You know, as a pastor and as sheep in this body, we have to be careful that wolves don't come in that want to try to bring something. I actually had a phone call from somebody that said, you know, I have this thought and I have that thought. And I said, you're welcome to come. There was a person that I don't know has attended. And the person said, well, I have this thought and that thought, and I tend to share my thoughts. And I said, well, if it's correct, you're okay. If it's incorrect, I'm going to stop you. Because I have an obligation to the flock to make sure that vomit is not being spewed and there's not false information being delivered or conjecture on your part. He hasn't been here, so I don't... When I was preparing this, let's make this real. This is what the Lord, I believe, said he gave to me. I want you to imagine being presented with an extremely dangerous situation. And you're given instructions on how to survive this situation. And your survival depends on it. And you're warned that a departure from the true instructions or miscalculations will result in your death. How much effort will you put into remembering those instructions? Do it like your life depends on it. Your eternal life does depend on it. When the Holy Spirit is saying, hear what the Spirit would say, our life depends on it. You know, it's like a father trying to help a child and saying, hey, you know, that's not a good idea. Been there, done that. Don't do this. It's not a good idea. Oh, what does Dad know? He's an old codger. What does he know? You don't get burned when you put your finger in fire. He doesn't know anything. The Holy Spirit is instructing us so that we avoid putting our finger in the fire sometimes. And if we miss it, we endure that because of it. Or we miss the mark and we go off on some direction and our focus and purpose is misguided. And the Lord says, remember, go back to the basics, to the beginning. And start over and remember how the Lord worked in your life when the power of God, because your life depends on it. And lastly, repent. Repent and turn to me again. Remember Ephesus? Remember what he said to Ephesus in verse 5 of Revelation 2. He said, remember there from where you have fallen and repent and do the first works. And remember the repent in the Greek, metaneo, meta and the oeo, is to change your mind, to amend how you're thinking. And if you look it up, it says to amend one's past sins. Change the way we're thinking, because the way we think will drive how we act, doesn't it? Don't we act based on what we think? What we see with our eyes? I'm not driving down that road. Look at that road. I'm going to take a different one. When I was driving on our trip, you know, the GPS is nice enough to show you the yellow where the traffic slows down and the red where it comes to a screeching halt. For the unknown reason, No idea. On the infamous Route 81 and 95, where there must appear to, maybe the spirit and the donkey stopping somewhere, because there's an angel stopping cars somewhere or something, but I just don't understand it. But you know, the Holy Spirit in our GPS, he's showing us the yellow and the red. Woo, glory to God, that's not even in the notes. He's showing us the yellow and the red. And he's saying, rerouting, when possible, make a U-turn. When possible, you know how many times I hear that? Make a U-turn. And that's what the Holy Spirit says to us sometimes. When possible, make a U-turn. The GPS is showing the road yellow, and then it's red. And it ain't good there in bad English. Get back and study the original playbook and remember your assignments and the truth of the purpose of your assignment. And get your head and your heart back in the game. Football season's coming. Get a little bit in there for you. You know, I used to say this about the game. It's one thing to play the game and to just do what your assignment says. It's one thing to understand the game and do your assignment and understand how your assignment affects the success of the team. What did you just say? So I'm a lineman. And back then, a few pounds lighter. Why does this 200-plus pound guy got to run down the field 15 yards and block some kid 135 pounds that's 15 yards away from the play? Why do I got to do that? Lord, why do I got to do that? Because ultimately, if the play goes as planned and you block that guy 15 down and everybody else blocks their person successfully, the quarterback, the running back, whoever has the ball, takes a ride. And he goes to that place at the end called the end zone. What's the end zone for us? Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away. The end zone for us is heaven. That's the score. We got to get back to the original playbook. You know, COVID has distorted and done some damage to the church. And we got to, I don't mean this pointing fingers. I say this to the church in general, to me, to all of us. We have to examine and say, rekindle that fire. Is this area of my life, is that area of my life need to be rekindled? Go back to our assignment. We have to acknowledge when we departure from the truth. And we must, with all intensity, make haste, use some scripture words here, to make haste and correct the error of our ways. Or, now that's next week. And Jesus says in the letter, turn to me again. What is he saying? Make Christ and my kingdom the focus and purpose of your life again. Make Christ and my kingdom. Remember I said a few weeks ago, we can do all the right things, and if it's for the wrong purpose? Pastor Joe spoke Thursday night about attitudes. God's a God of motives and attitudes. Paul's attitude in the scripture was that he cared so deeply. He had such a heart for people and their salvation. And he wrote these letters and the epistles, and he wrote these to the churches. And he spoke to them to encourage them, to build them up in faith. And as he spoke, I was sitting there, and it just, you know, sometimes light bulbs do go on in there. And it was like, and the Lord said, you know what? Yeah, Paul was giving his experiences and saying to them, look, I've been there. Look, I was terrible. I was awful. And I made these mistakes. I made that mistake. I thought about this and I thought about that, blah, 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 blah. And he said to them, and all of his writings were to guide them in perfect truth. Perfect truth, complete, full truth. The truth of the word of God. The whole truth and nothing but the truth. So help us, God. Holy Spirit, right? Glory to God. You never know what's going to come out. As I finish today, he says to them, I see all your works. Works that give everyone around you the appearance that you are alive and well. You have a great name. You have a great reputation as you are the church. But I see you and I see your works for who you really are, and you are dead. You know, remember I tell you this story all the time, and I'm sorry. They say you're not supposed to repeat yourself in services. But I have to tell you, you know, I tell this story that in back to sports, how I thought I did such a wonderful job in a game, how I did such a great blocking on offense, and I went in gym class and walked up to the coach and said, how were the films? Because I'm expecting him to say how wonderful everything was. Because we won, right? And I said, how were the films, coach? Horrible. Let me show you. I think I want to do something else. And the Lord's saying to us, let me show you. Hear what I have to say. Listen to what the Holy Spirit is speaking to you. It's just not an exercise. Oh, we got a message in tongues this week. Yep, we do it every week. Yep, we hear this and we hear that. There's a purpose in it. It's for us. It isn't just for the purpose to spout it out. And you know, as Pastor Joe said Thursday night, sometimes it isn't always right on. But the Lord brings it around. And he puts it back together. He said to Sardis, you maintain a facade of religion, but your conduct denies its validity. We have to bring validity to the gospel of the Jesus in our lives. And you know, some people say, well, I don't do bad things. But the Lord always impresses on me, but do you trust the Lord? And do people see that in your life? Do you show your faith in the Lord by your actions and how you live? And how do we trust him? He said to them, your works are purposed in building your earthly kingdom and not centered on building my eternal kingdom. He said to them, you need to wake up and watch out. Danger is lurking. Danger is seeking to devour you. You've fallen asleep and you left yourself unguarded. The enemy is compassing about you and you are asleep, unguarded, vulnerable to attack and destruction because you've become complacent in your own self-confidence. Sardis, your armor is hanging in the closet and your armaments are left unguarded. The armor's hanging in the closet. The Bible's dusty. Now wake up and remember what you were taught when you were first accepted the Lord and the good news that you were given before you departed from the truth and fell asleep. Go back and rekindle the spark and reignite the flame. Hold on to the truth you were taught. Keep remembering it. Don't forget it. Turn back to Jesus. Turn back to the purpose that and the focus that Christ wants us to have. Hear what the Spirit has to say. And follow his instructions. And everybody said, amen. Lord, I thank you today for a powerful word. Lord, I thank you today, Lord, that you are trying to wake up the church. Not, I don't mean just First Assembly, but the church in general, Lord. That we not be lulled to sleep in the complacency of our own self-confidence. Thinking that we've got it all together when we really don't. All we have is what you give us, Lord. Lord, I pray that we would bear in mind, Lord, that you're our strength. It is you, Lord, that gives us strength. Lord, I pray that we would be awake to the enemy, both those things that we see and both the things we don't see. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities of darkness in high places. We wrestle in the spirit world, and we must not leave our armament in the closet. We must not leave our hearts and our minds unguarded, that the enemy seeks to come in and to destroy with his lies, with his misinformation, with his distortions of the truth. Well, this is okay today. Lord, I pray today that we might rekindle the flame of the Holy Spirit, that we might let the Holy Spirit direct us. Show us the way today, Lord. For there is no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Lord, I thank you today. May your word resonate in our hearts, in our minds. May you be our strength. May we hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. May he speak to us and we listen to his direction. Let us recognize, Lord, that our eternal life depends on it. And I thank you, Lord, for all that you do. I thank you for your people here in this body. I thank you, Lord, for their commitment to you. Let us not be dulled into complacency. Let us not fall asleep as a church or individually. But, Lord, strengthen us. Let us rekindle. Let us be revived. Lord, I thank you for it today. Now, go with each and every person, Lord, I pray a blessing upon them. I pray that you bless them. I pray that you keep them. I pray that your countenance will shine down upon them, Lord. And I pray that you give them your peace, Lord. And the communion of your Holy Spirit would be with them. And continue to minister to all of us, I pray, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. God bless you. Praise the Lord.